specified by biological mechanisms, are you suggesting that that would be, that that would replace a taxonomy, the kinds of taxonomies that we have now?
No, I just think it's sort of one way we can think about it. I strongly feel that simply because something's genetically influenced doesn't mean the environment's not important. In fact, you know, research shows the temperament, but the environment accounts for a lion's share of the influences and the variants on various temperament dimensions. So I think that it's not going to solely answer the question. But I think we want to think about these things is if I expect this trait to fall under, or the subject to fall under a component, a larger component, you know, what do I expect of that? Do I expect that they have an underlying common genome?
Sandee and Marcel, do you want to add anything to this question of the elements?
Yeah, I think one of the nicest things that has occurred over the time of the field, 25 years, is that we spend less time arguing over how many dimensions, what their names are, and there seems to be more consensus in moving in the direction of some sort of agreement, even if some person calls it negative activity, another person calls it negative reactivity, they're close enough that we're coming to a common dimension.
Well, maybe one thing I would add is that the field is quite obsessed with these dimensions, and perhaps too little attention is being paid to types. To use an analogy from medicine, you don't have more or less of a pneumonia, you don't have more or less of a cold. It's a state that emerges from several parameters having reached a certain level, and then something new emerges. And I think it would probably also be possible to think of temperament in those terms. I'm not really seeing it happening apart from your work and also some new developments that Roy presented this morning. So I think perhaps we should pay a bit more attention to types and not always, you know, argue about these dimensions, which is an important part as well.
All right, questions from the audience on this issue of the elements in the temperament. Yeah.
I'm wondering whether you think there might be some mechanism for identifying new elements or different elements than the ones that we're currently talking about. Or, say, taking an element such as negative emotionality and really seeing, is there a distinction between the tendency to experience negative affective states or the reactive component, which is the instability kind of that, things trigger it quickly, and whether that is different. And should we, will we come to some sense of rethinking some of this for the future, or are we set with the ones we have now?
I think it's a great point. I cannot answer the question in a specific way, but I think one of the dangers of having these these taxonomies or these sort of agreed upon dimensions is, first of all, that it may prevent us to discover new important elements of temperament. So once we agree all that there is positive emotionality, negative emotionality, affective control, we're all, in a way, thinking in a mold. And that could be a certain problem. And the second problem I see is the lack of specificity. These concepts such as positive emotionality, negative, are just highly unspecific. Now, I know that there are subfacets to these, but people really like to talk and communicate on these very sort of second order level dimensions. And I just see a certain danger in that, I have to say.
See, I would say that it all be determined by your research question. You know, if you want to turn the microscope up infinitely to study, you know, the sub components of certainty, if you believe that you know, this sub component is going to be relate differently to an important outcome than this sub component, I don't see it being dangerous. But I do believe that would, I feel that the people before us have been so comprehensive and really have. It's hard to imagine what, of course it's hard to imagine what new elements might be out there. So I think that one way to progress would be more finely differentiated.
So, all right, I'll put out things I think are temperament that aren't on the current list. So how about, why would something like empathy, differences in empathy, not be on the list? Or aggression. Aggression is identified as a temperament trait across species, right? It's very basic. It emerges quite early in life. So what about those?
To me, empathy is too cognitive. It's once you're invoking something that you just absolutely cannot study in animals. I think that for me anyway.
All right, empathy. How about nurturance? Right? You could study that in animals, right? And people do.
No, I'd say something like agreeableness, which empathy is a part of. Mm-hmm. It could be a temperament trait. I'd say empathy specifically is where I don't think it could be.
About others?
I think what is also being neglected are individual differences in sexuality and sexual desire, for example. I mean, that could be also a possible temperament trait. And I think it's probably neglected because it's very difficult to study.
And it doesn't emerge in him.
Right. It doesn't
emerge in him. I mean,
Freud was
yes, indeed.
But
it
doesn't nurture. I think we have a tremendous problem separating outcomes from temperament and what comes first and what is a process and what is an outcome. And not all individual differences are temperament.
One question per person for now. We'll come back because I just want to make sure. See, do we have other questions?
Sure.
We have repeat customers. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll come back to you, Bill.
How could we be close? Since in your statement that 98 homes work, 99% of that work is from parent reports. Now, it seems to me that parents are like a microscope with a very, very neat magnifying glass. They don't notice everything, they don't language everything. So it is highly unlikely that if we had parent reports from 99% of parents in the world, we'd even be close to what the basic temperament is.
But I would say that the things we study through parent reports were identified through a number of different ways. So just speaking from Mary's perspective, looking at and from yours, looking at ancient philosophies regarding temperament, regarding these ideas, looking at the behavioral genetics literature, looking at the animal literature, I would say that that even though that a lot of us have chosen to study parents' impressions, I don't think that that's really where we identified the individual differences that we are interested in, and that we consider temperament. I think, you know, over thousands of years of observing human behavior, it's hard for me to believe that, and there are geniuses in this room, that any of us is going to come up with a new observation of a new individual difference.
Why? I mean, we know that humans, particularly humans differ in their sensitivity to sweetness. And that would be a powerful temperamental thing. Parents would have no idea. Just none.
I speak for a few clinicians here in saying that we have a preference for traits and parts of temperament that are clinically available, that can be seen by parents and described to us, that we can see ourselves, and that is what Thomas suggested, and we have found that does it pretty well for us. And I must say that most of us, speaking for myself anyway, do not find that the process of factor analysis makes it any better for us clinically.
Yeah, there are different purposes, right, for identifying the traits.
I think it's useful for identifying what might be basic elements.
If you're doing personality research, it's perhaps different, but if you're looking for things that you as a clinician are going to be dealing with, it has to be things that are readily observable and available.
Yeah, but the question was about the basic elements, so I guess I was taking that as neurological elements or basic elements that can explain a variety of different differences. So yeah, I was answering a different question.
question.
I just, in response to Jerry's comments, I mean, there is, of course, this unit of sensory sensitivity that is present in a few temperament models and that relates to these issues such as sensitivity to sour taste, to sweet taste, and so on. So it has been thought of, I guess. It doesn't, I mean, there is not a huge empirical literature on it. But it has a home. It has a home in some of the current models of temperament.
Yes,
go ahead,
listening to the elements, I presented this morning a paper about fractal analysis of tree temperament models and also one personality model. And of course, the three that were mentioned by Sam were there. But there were two, activity and sensitivity. Sensitivity has come up, but activity, I haven't heard anybody talking about activity, although it's part of each of the classic temperamental models.
I agree that I'm sort of a little bit also confused about the status of activity level and energy. Where do these belong to? I know that there is a sort of a tendency now to allocate into positive emotionality, but you know, and I think that was sort of the idea of Preston Thomas with the dimension of intensity. I mean, you can be very energetic in the negative emotionality domain as well. So I'm just wondering about this energy component. It seems a very temperamental component to me, but it seems sort of homeless.
But it's defined differently in different. Yeah. It's defined differently in different models, and so there's a kind of activity that goes with positive emotionality, which is this kind of productive, just positive engagement, and then there's the kind of activity that is reflecting a kind of just poor control that turns out to be a risk factor for all kinds of.
Yes, but not only. You see, now you're sort of again allocating it. But I mean, clearly, some people have a tendency to do things in a more vigorous and quick way across different categories of behavior, and some are just slow, and then the speed component, there's a speed component to human behavior, and I think that's very temperamental, but I'm not sure it's studied very, very closely.
In adults, it's pretty, I mean, that aspect of the kind of high energy, generally, it falls along the lines of extroversion. And when you do observations of people, I mean, you can see that very clearly, that more extroverted people have more expression of energy.
Even though the so-called ancient choleric type is not really an extrovert, and still is a fast kind of type.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ivan?
Can I still add to this? I agree with you, because activity is something very important for young children, and as I showed you, or tried to show you, later on, it becomes merged with extroversion. It becomes part of a broader factor. But for very young children, activity is independent of all the other dimensions of temperament. And sensitivity, to come back to that, is also an important factor for the younger ages. Unfortunately, I didn't find any correlates of sensitivity so far. So that may be the problem with sensitivity.
Okay, let's move on to the next question. So we have a question here about the extent to which that temperament changes versus staying the same. So when we talk about change, we can think about change in multiple ways. So we're thinking here of two basic ways. One has to do with rank order stability, and the other has to do with mean level stability. Kim is going to take up this question.
Well, as you all know, most of the research looking at change has focused on rank order change, and that's, you know, understandable since we're individual differences people, and we're interested in individual differences. And as I'm sure you're all well aware, the correlations are moderate, right? Age-to-age correlations are moderate, indicating that there's some stability, but there's a fair amount of change. I make a caution that one of the things that we see, and I've seen it, and I know other people have seen it, is that you get higher stability ratings when you use parent ratings as opposed to observers. And observers are mechanical measures, I guess, motion measures. And that raises the question as to whether some of the stability that we get with parent ratings resides in their rating behaviors. So that's something that we have to deal with. Another issue that we have to deal with regard to the instability is that if you're using different measures across different ages, then to some extent you're measuring different behaviors. And that may be contributing to